If everyone could please be quiet.
June.
Take your seats.
7th. Planning board meeting. My name is Kathy Barnard. I'm the chairman of the planning board. Let me introduce the other members. I wish you would be quiet. Thank you. To my right, Mike Hodder. Sitting next to Mike, Stacy Pope, who is the vice chairman of the planning board. To my left, John Thurston, and Paul O'Brien, and Von Dugan. Okay, so the way that this works, we have four scheduled appointments. And the way that we function with these is that Rob Hausman, our planning and development director, makes a presentation, and Brad Harriman has just arrived. He's the selectman's representative on the planning board. So after Rob's presentation, the applicant then has an opportunity to give us any information about the application that they care to. Sometimes there are waivers involved, and if there are waivers, the applicant needs to give us some justification as to why the planning board can grant the waivers. Once that's completed, and during those two presentations, planning board members can ask questions. Once the presentations are completed, planning board then needs to determine if we can grant the waivers. If we determine that we can, make a motion and vote on that. And then once that takes place, that means that the application is complete and we can go to the public hearing. And that's when people would have an opportunity to comment on the application. So that's the way we operate here. Now, the first application, Families in Transition, Green Mountain Realty, LLC. This is 16-18 Laner Street, tax map 217-70, case 201607. This is a change of use to a temporary family transition housing. Let me, just to remind everybody, we did open this hearing in May 3rd, 2016, where we had a combined meeting with the ZBA. At that time, a site walk was conducted, so all of the members of the planning board have seen the site and the building. We had testimony was taken at that time. The applicant gave a presentation, and then we turned it over to the ZBA, and planning board members really couldn't comment at that point in time. We then concluded that hearing, and it was continued until May 10th because of the need for some additional information. We met on May 10th and again continued this matter until the ZBA meeting last night, which was June 6th. Now, last night, the ZBA granted the required variance for a temporary family transition housing in the Central Business District. That means that this use is now a given, because that was what the applicant had to go to ZBA for. They needed a variance. The ZBA determined that there was adequate information to grant the variance. So, really, during our public hearing, you can say, I guess, what you want to say, but the use is no longer in discussion. It has been established. So it's now the responsibility of the planning board to conduct a site plan review, and that's what we're about to do. The use, as I said, has already been established, and we now have to be satisfied that the proposed project is in accordance with all the town ordinances and in accordance with the master plan. We need to provide for the safe and attractive development of the site and guard against such conditions that would involve danger or injury to health and safety. Mainly, in this case, the development of the site, we're not even looking at that because this is a interior project, and the development of the site is things like drainage and things of that nature. But we do have to concern ourselves with fire safety and other issues of that nature. The Planning Board can propose conditions that will address health, safety, convenience, and prosperity. So, now, Mr. Hausman, you're on.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to reference, for everyone's benefit, the site plan over here. This site plan shows the building in question, the parking lot to the rear, Laner Street, Lennon Street. Lennon Street parking lot and beyond is Foss Field, the electric building, and the community center, just for purposes of orientation. The proposal tonight is to convert the third floor to temporary transitional housing for families facing homelessness. It's 7 bedrooms to temporary house 5 to 7 families at a time. Community dining and a meeting room is proposed, a children's room is proposed, kitchen, laundry facilities, and a professional staff office on the third floor. The second floor, which is not an issue for our discussion, will be converted to support offices associated with this use. The first floor, there's no proposed change. The applicant has a letter of intent submitted as part of the application and has sought and received a variance. That variance was granted last night, and the final action on that variance will be on next Monday night to affirm the notice that will be developed by council. This process traditionally is reserved for new development or additions or changes in the land. Nothing is proposed on this site that's being modified on the site affecting transportation, driveways, storm drainage, parking, landscaping, or anything else. So I'm going to walk through all the issues that we customarily address and note that they're not applicable. Access not applicable. It remains unchanged. Parking and circulation not applicable. Again, it's a pre-existing commercial use. The central business district is exempt from parking for requiring additional parking. This site is not proposing any changes that would trigger any use of additional parking. Storm drainage not applicable. No changes are being proposed that affect storm drainage. Utilities, no changes, not applicable. Lighting, I'm going to say not applicable. The board may want to have a conversation with the applicant or their agent to discuss whether or not there is any proposed lighting changes to the exterior of the building that should be noted as part of this process. Protection of natural resources, not applicable. No change to the site, no impact to wetlands. Zoning compliance, it's already been noted that a variance was required and received, which moves us along to litter storage. Litter storage, not applicable. It's already on site. No changes proposed. Floodplain, I'll note that the previous plan does have a note on it that shows that this property falls outside the flood hazard boundaries of the town of Wolfboro, as shown on the FEMA rate maps for the town. Security for improvements, none proposed, none required. Signage, none noted. The board may wish to clarify that point. Design review, there's no proposed change to the building. There's no proposed change in any way to this building on the exterior that would trigger design review. This is one of those site plan review is a catch-all system where we have the highest standard adopted. If you want relief from that high standard of engineered plans and everything else, you need a waiver. The applicant is requesting that this plan, which shows the existing site conditions, be adopted by reference and allow the waiver of the site plan review regs so that they don't have to have a new survey, new site plan worked up.
And we've already used the site plan for a previous application for the property.
Yes, in 2014, the applicant, the current owner, submitted and received approval for the conversion of this portion of the property to parking. That approval shows all the site improvements, the stormwater improvements, the landscaping buffer and that's duly noted on the plan. With that, Madam Chair, I would say that the application is complete and ready for acceptance subject to the granting of the requested waiver. At this time, I'd ask that the applicant's agent be able to give a brief overview and address any concerns the board may have.
Okay, could you just do a brief explanation of how we arrived at the parking requirements,
please? Wolfboro's Planning and Zoning Ordinance defines uses. Wolfboro Planning and Zoning Ordinance defines parking requirements for those uses. When you apply the ordinance to parking in the Central Business District, a dwelling unit triggers parking. When you apply the definition of a dwelling unit, these spaces as transitional housing does not constitute a dwelling unit. It's housing multiple families. It would be the equivalent in a like manner as an inn or hotel with a common space, the ability to have a meal. So when you go through the process as a zoning administrator does, in consult with council, we've concluded that this is not a residential use triggering commercial parking. In addition, the site has parking on currently has parking on site.
Thank you. Any questions before Rob sits down? Okay.
If you need it, it's the green button.
Okay, now if the applicant and the public will remember that we have heard the presentation and we've also received all of the documentations, the letters and things of that nature.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Nicole Caesar, attorney at Walker & Barney, here on behalf of the applicant, Families in Transition. I only do have a few items to discuss with you, bearing in mind the prior presentation that we did give. And so first off, I do just want to start with a waiver, requesting a waiver that the plan that is currently already in the board's file be acceptable as part of our application. In terms of this waiver, we're asking for that waiver from those formalities, in part because there was so much feedback yesterday, I still have that in the back of my mind. So there won't be any exterior changes. No site improvements are proposed or required. We did provide copies of this plan with our application, but this plan, like I've already stated, was already part of the record file, which was approved by the planning board on January 20th of 2015. So this lot line adjustment plan is the title of it, together with the conceptual drawing of the third floor that we've submitted, is adequate given the scope of the proposal, and it also meets the spirit and the intent of the planning board regulations. If we were to prepare a plan that is in strict compliance with the regulations, we would otherwise incur arguably otherwise unnecessary costs, and we're only dealing with a change of use for the interior of the structure. Secondly, I do want to talk about the signage and the lighting. There are no proposed changes as part of our application for any changes to the signage or the lighting. If anything is proposed in the future, it will be done either as a separate application or permit where necessary, and it'll all be done in accordance with the zoning ordinance. I did have an opportunity to receive and take a look at Rob Hausman's planner review that he prepared for this evening, and I did notice that there are a number of proposed conditions for the application, and I did want to take a brief bit of time just to speak about some of the concerns that we have with the conditions that are included on page 8 and 9, and those are the conditions that are under the heading of staffing, participant responsibility, children, cleaning, guests, respectful community, and safety. And so that translates to paragraph 1 under the proposed approval on page 10. The reasons for our concerns are that these conditions all apply to the interior of the space. They also deal with Families in Transition's programming, as well as its business plan and practices. The conditions are not land use controls. They don't actually relate to the actual use of the land, but rather they are conditions on the people using the land. For example, under participant responsibility, it involves the requirement that residents meet with the case manager a certain number of times each week. Similarly, it says that they must engage in programming, and it includes a condition that they not share access codes to their bedrooms. Furthermore, these proposed conditions are virtually unenforceable. For example, one of them is to clean your room and bathroom. And so these are for each of the 7 bedrooms that are interior all the way up on the 3rd floor. Similarly, there's a requirement that the residents participate in house responsibilities. In the same way that the planning board would not necessarily adopt similar conditions for a guest at a bed and breakfast or at an inn or a multifamily unit dwelling, such as curfews, supervising children, keeping personal items in your bedroom, the conditions are not appropriate here. Families in Transition has had 25 years of success running multiple facilities throughout the state and applying its policies, rules, regulations as part of its best practices. Families in Transition did give a presentation of those policies, rules, and procedures. They did so candidly, openly, honestly, as part of that initial presentation on May 3rd. Everything was done in good faith to show how they as an organization run their operation. There is no reason for this board to doubt that they will continue to do so without these conditions in place as part of this approval. I also note that Families in Transition is a nonprofit. They're run by a board of directors who are bound by fiduciary duties and responsibilities to its mission and to the public that it serves, which includes these best practices as detailed as part of that presentation. Families in Transition is best suited and has the most experience to determine and implement those best practices to meet the needs and to best serve the building residents and the community as a whole. That includes adding any additional policies, rules, or procedures that aren't part of this list that may include changing some of the items in certain ways that are on here. Not only are there difficulties or even impossibilities in terms of enforcement from that perspective, but in the event that Families in Transition saw it fit to change any of these policies, rules, and regulations that are incorporated as part of these conditions, or to make an exception, it would be very difficult to do so without having to go back to the planning board, and it would create far more problems and possible obstructions than it would solve. I do specifically want to discuss the noise curfew, because that one does seem to be a bit different from some of the other conditions that have been included, and that while FIT does and will implement rules regarding noise, it's asking that these also don't be that these are not a condition of its approval. Wolfboro has its own chapter of the zoning ordinance governing noise, and Families in Transition would like that to continue to serve to regulate the noise in the town. As Chief Willard of the Manchester Police Department testified yesterday, these temporary residents who are going to be living in this building are human beings, they're people, they're children. The noise ordinance that serves the residents and guests of Wolfboro will be adequate for those guests at Families in Transition as well. And if the board has any additional questions, that's all I had to share.
Okay, these conditions were suggested mainly because the applicant presented them as part of the public record.
And I don't know.
But we will be discussing them later. Anybody have any questions at this point?
Yeah.
Okay.
So there'll be no external lighting other than what's already there, if there is any there?
Only existing lighting. There are no proposed changes.
And you don't anticipate any external sign on the building or hanging from the building saying Families in Transition or anything of that sort?
As of right now, I know that there is currently one sign in place that has spaces available for any additional names to be included. That sign's already in place, and I believe you just slip in whatever additional names may be included. But as of right now, as part of this application, there is no additional signage.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Could you explain the kind of materials or services that might be coming to and leaving the facility, you know, food supply, linen supply, that sort of traffic? I know last night that was an issue that the planning board was left with, so we should talk about that.
I'm going to ask Maureen to help me address this question.
Okay. Yes, folks.
I'm sorry, could you ask that again, please?
There was an issue last night raised about truck service traffic, and so I wonder what kind of supplies come and go, and what's the normal procedure for linens, food, you know, just a delivery of personal possessions, you know, what is normal?
Mm-hmm. Folks will not be bringing along any of their furniture and those kinds of things. There isn't room for it, and people have to store it, or oftentimes people simply don't have anything other than the clothing that they're bringing with them. The other thing is that it's for seven families, so it's a smaller facility. So the laundry, we have picked up by a laundry cleaner, and they come and take the sheets and those kinds of things so that they're sanitized. And then in regards to food, we have a van, and we go pick up food with the van and bring it back. Occasionally, there may be a truck that's delivering larger items, but it's not something that happens on a regular basis. There's no big food truck that drives up and offloads items.
That was my concern, Vaughn. I think I was the one who raised that issue last night, and from what I heard from Maureen, I would not have any further concerns regarding deliveries.
Well, last night I became a little concerned that we were perhaps over-regulating something that didn't seem to be any different than anyone else in the neighborhood. So I just questioned why that seemed like it might be an issue.
So when you have the deliveries, will you be doing them down back or out in the front? Because the bigger truck might squeeze the road there and cause a safety issue, or any consideration there?
I would imagine that the delivery would be according to whatever size truck was coming. Again, when we set up a facility, we do have large trucks coming because we have furniture delivered and those kinds of things. But after that, we go out and we buy the food and we bring it back in our van. There really isn't a big food truck that comes, and that's the only thing that comes to mind. We do have a program in our facility in Manchester whereby we have beds that we store, brand new beds, box spring mattress and the metal frame, so that when people leave and they go into an apartment, if they need it, we can provide that for them. And occasionally we have a big truck deliver that, but that is really probably once every 5 months, 6 months or so. And here it's a much smaller program. So we would follow whatever the rule is to delivery. I know that the facility itself had lots of trucks going in and out, in and out, in and out. And there is a turnaround in the back and a place for delivery in the back, and we would probably just follow that. In addition, the first floor is still going to have commercial tenants in it, and so as a landlord, they're going to be respectful of the tenants and their businesses, and so all deliveries and all activities are going to be done to cause the least amount of interference.
Thank you. Other questions? Board members, go ahead, Stacey.
What is the current litter storage and pickup and delivery at this time? Because it says already on site. So is that a dumpster? I'm not familiar with where that is right now.
Unfortunately, we're not aware about the current pickup and drop off times. We could see if we could get any additional information. But beyond that, without any knowledge.
In the back.
Okay, everyone all set? OK, Okay, it seems that the applicant has given us justification for granting the required waiver. As I indicated earlier, we've already waived this requirement for a previous application for this property, and it really is not needed due to the fact that there are no changes to the exterior. So would somebody be willing to make a motion to grant the waivers?
I move that we grant the waiver of the reiteration of the site plan, because we have one that is perfectly up to date. It was dated 2015 and very adequate. We've seen it before.
Second.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. All right, now that the waiver has been granted, the application is complete. And so again, if somebody would be make a motion to accept this application as complete.
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. All right. Now going to open the public hearing. And any member of the public that wants to speak to this application, if you would come on up, give us your name and your thoughts.
My name is Kirk Gilmore. I live at 50 Union Street. You started out the meeting, Madam Chairman, by talking about the master plan for the community, which I think was established in 2007. The opening of that introduction states that it applies to residents. The people that are going to be staying at this place are not necessarily Wolf Bowl residents. FIT describes this as an organization that is going to be for the community, and they describe the community as people that go to the to the Governor Wentworth School District, which encompasses five or six towns outside of Wolfboro. So many of the people that are going to be staying here, actually the majority of the people that will be staying here, are not residents of Wolfboro.
Thank you.
Charles Weeble, 223 North Line Road here in Wolfboro. Two subjects. First of all, I'm somewhat confused as to exactly who is the applicant before the planning board here. What we've been told here in town in newspaper articles and general word on the street is that this is a privately funded purchase, privately rehabilitated, and privately paid to the Families in Transition Group. In other words, the Families in Transition has nothing to do with this building financially. And the reason for that was brought forward is that allows the town of Wolfboro to discriminate against anybody coming into this facility that does not belong to the current SAU. Now, if the group in front of you now is Families in Transition, they receive better than 50% of their funding from federal and state and local governments. Hence, there is no way that they can discriminate and keep anyone who applies, whether they come from Seattle, Washington, New York City, or Wolfboro, for being in this facility. So I would like to have someone explain to me exactly which way this thing is going. That's number one. Number two, in terms of the safety, I'm surprised that there is no one from the fire department here to speak to putting seven families on the third floor of a wooden building, irrespective of the fact that it is sprinklered. In the original application, and I can't see this one from here, there was only one means of egress from the third floor. I know there are two there now, but one of the bedroom overlays that second staircase. That needs to be addressed. In reading the federal building codes, Families in Transition come under homelessness, and homelessness is lumped together with boarding houses in terms of the definitions for the building code. In that, it states that in any rehabilitation that spends more than 20% of the cost of the facility, it's considered a new building. It's not considered a fix-up. In that, every two living units must have a firewall that goes through, up through to the roof in that. So you will want to look at that when you're approving building plans, that every two bedrooms has to have a firewall. Kitchen facilities and boarding houses are considered commercial restaurants. Therefore, they must be at the same code as any restaurant downtown, which includes a hood, Ansel suppression systems, and all of the other safety facilities that are built into a commercial kitchen. So that is my thing there. But I'm surprised. I would urge you not to vote on this until you hear from the fire department as to what they consider whether this is a safe facility. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. According to the...
Could we get somebody from somewhere to answer that question this evening as to who,
yes, I was
who
just
is
about
going
to
own
do
and
that.
Operate this and who is
I was just about to do that, sir. According to the information we have, the applicant is Families in Transition and Green Mountain Realty, LLC. I believe I mentioned that at the very beginning. Does the applicant want to comment on those issues now rather than wait?
You are very much correct in stating who the applicant is and the owner of record, and there should be no more further confusion on that matter, I hope. In terms of funding, that was more of an issue for, to some degree, for the zoning board, although that relevance is somewhat questionable. But in terms of any funding and sources of funding and implications for funding, I unfortunately see no real application here in that regard before the planning board. In terms of safety, the property is fully sprinkled. It's my understanding that the fire department has submitted either a letter or an email or some documentation of their support in terms of building and in the construction of the proposed use. Families in Transition fully intends that everything will be code compliant, building compliant, and meet any other code or regulation that they are required to do so.
Okay.
Madam Chairman.
Thank you.
as part of the ZBA packet, we received a letter from Assistant Deputy Chief Tom Zotti regarding those particulars that were raised by Mr. Weibel. If you'd like, I could read that into the record, unless it's already part of the record of this.
Well, it is part of the record, but why don't you read it?
All right, just for the public's interest then. Right. This is a letter dated April 26 to Maureen Beauregard, signed by Tom Zotti, Deputy Chief, Wolfboro Fire Rescue. Dear Ms. Beauregard, I've had the opportunity to meet at the site with you, the project architect, the Wolfboro building official, and others to review this proposal. We discussed general requirements of the New Hampshire Fire Code and how they would be addressed in the project. It appears to me that all parties understand the requirements and the project will be compliant with the New Hampshire Fire Code. Specific compliance details will be reviewed at the time a building permit application is submitted for the renovations. Please contact me if I can be of further assistance. Sincerely, Tom Zotti. So essentially, it's the same procedure that any building would go under when Tom came to inspect it.
Right. Thank you. Yes, the fire department has met with the applicant, has been to the building, and just to look at it initially. But if the application is approved, that's when the fire department and the code officer and go into the building and work with the building owners or applicant and deal with all of these specific issues. So they definitely will be dealt with because they're part of the state code. Okay. Anyone else?
It's also part of the regular building permit application. It's separate from the site plan review that we're doing today.
Anyone else? Okay, planning board members, Mr. Hausman, do you have some conditions that we should?
I wonder if we should discuss the applicability of all of the
rules. We're going to do that, and I was going to do that before I close the public hearing. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I offer the following conditions of approval, and I'm going to start on page 10, unless you want me to read through pages 7, 8, and 9.
I think those are probably, I mean, you can start on page 10, but probably we're going to need to go backwards. I think those are the ones that people may want to talk about.
Okay. The planning board, so staff is recommending the following conditions of approval be considered. One, that the operations and residency standards noted above and proposed by the applicant in this application are hereby adopted by reference. Condition two, the following plans as amended by the planning board's approval are incorporated into this approval, and it's the lot line revision plan and the families in transition conceptual plan as shown here. Condition three, the applicant shall be responsible for the payment of all recording fees. Condition four, the applicant's engineer shall submit a letter certifying compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act. We may want to expand that to say engineer, architect, or ADA compliance certified individual. Those are the three individuals noted by Department of Justice. Condition five, that the zoning board notice of decision and any conditions attached thereto or shall be adopted by reference. Condition six, all of the documentation submitted in this application packet and the applicant and by the applicant and any requirements imposed by other agencies are part of this approval unless otherwise updated, revised, clarified in some manner, or suspended in full or in part. In the case of conflicting information between documents, the most recent documentation in this notice herein shall be generally determining. Those are the six conditions staff is recommending. Okay. With regards to condition one refers to the notice that the property would be staffed 24 hours a day, that there'll be an awake overnight staff, there'll be a manager for the site, there'll be a volunteer coordinator, and there'll be part-time maintenance. And then with regards to participant responsibility, it talks to meeting with service coordinator and engaging in programming. The children shall be supervised at all time. Supervised children in the common areas in the of the shelter, including room, dining, living room, dining room, and hallways. It speaks to cleaning your room and bathroom, participating in house responsibilities. Lists posted responsibilities will include meal preparation and service, serving in the kitchen, sweeping and mopping in the common area, including the laundry room, living room, and stairwells. Guests, there will be no guests in the shelter, the shelter residents in the building at any time. Respect for the community, noise curfew, 9 p.m. to 7 a.m. Adults return to their bedrooms by 11:30 unless otherwise approved by FIT. Safety, each participant will have a code of access, code to access the shelter, bedroom, and personal safe. Each code is unique to the participant and it shall not be shared. Should staff become aware of family sharing codes, the shelter stay will be terminated. When entering and leaving, and this needs to be clarified because it clearly was from a different location. The shelter, you must always use the front door on, and it's so that if we're gonna keep it, to be clarified. Enter and exit doors are not to be propped open. This includes the front entry in the facility and the entry into the shelter stairwell. No use or possession of alcohol or illegal drugs or misuse of prescription is allowed on the premises, on or off the premises. If fit, family place staff witness illegal substance in your possession, the police will be notified immediately. All participants have the right to be free of abuse, neglect, and exploitation, including freedom from verbal, nonverbal, mental, or physical abuse and neglect. Absolutely no violence will be tolerated. This includes physical, sexual, verbal, and emotional abuse or violence. A safe is provided in each unit to use to store medication, wallets, money, and other small items. All persons' personal items need to remain in their bedroom unit, and no No use of candles, incense, or flammable materials permitted on the property, and all participants are expected to return to the shelter by 8 p.m., and the front door will be locked at that time. It should be noted that the 8 p.m. requirement has an exemption for those who work outside those hours. And I'd be happy to answer any questions or discuss them.
Yes, and there was an issue about the truck deliveries that you talked about last night.
That, I think, has been put to rest.
Okay.
Thank you to Vaughn.
Okay, so why don't we go through and see how everybody feels about the conditions. They are unenforceable, but they are the responsibility of the occupant and the applicant. And so they were put in here for discussion. So let's discuss.
I do recall hearing a presentation that these policies will be in place, but I also understand the impossibility of working with the board of directors and just individuals and adapting and changing and, you know, moving rules around to fit the appropriate, you know, help that they're providing to individuals. And it has to be flexible. These are people, you know, it's an operation ongoing. So I think perhaps we can keep all of these because it was represented, but we could perhaps add something at the base that allows some kind of flexibility, you know, or such standards that, you know, are adopted to ensure health, safety, welfare, you know, lack of whatever kind of language we want, so that there's some flexibility in it, because these are so specific right now. If they change from 3 hours to four, you know, do they have to come back?
That's the problem. If any of these rules, which are all internal rules, and they're not really, in my opinion, rules that the planning board has any business trying to enforce, change for any reason whatsoever, if the part-time maintenance person becomes full-time because now they have the money to pay for a full-time, they have to come back here because they were in breach of one of the conditions of approval. If we were dealing with a bed and breakfast application, we would not be imposing these sorts of regulations on the people coming to the bed and breakfast. If we were thinking about an inn, we would not be telling the innkeeper when his guests can and can't come in, how, through what door, and at what times they're allowed to make noise, and when they have to go to bed. I think that these sorts of conditions imposed here, they're inapplicable, and they're certainly unenforceable. How would anybody, including the code enforcement officer, know that someone was in bed when they were supposed to be and had come in the right door?
Lord, we hope that doesn't happen.
So I feel myself that condition number one of the six conditions should be expunged.
Okay. We're a land use board. That's what we are. We're supposed to take care of how land is used, and this is internal stuff. So I have, just as a general feeling, an objection to this. However, these are representations made by the applicant. And these were part of the collateral that we've looked at. And so we should pay attention to that stuff. But I wonder how we would enforce, to Mike's point, how we would enforce some of these things. So we're a land use board. I don't want to be inside the building, but telling people when the curfew begins and when it ends and whether you should or shouldn't have a safe. But I am concerned, and I think we're all concerned, that these are representations that the community is going to expect be adhered to. So to Vaughn's suggestion, maybe at the beginning of this, we say that the applicant has represented the following. Not that we're going to enforce it, because I don't think code enforcement is going to go inside the building. But this is what the applicant has represented as the operating policies and procedures for this facility. And we all hope and pray that we don't have to call the applicant and say, people are throwing things out the window or things are happening at the wrong time during the day. I also am sensitive to the fact that we have current ordinances in the town that regulate noise and things of that nature. And where those apply, they should apply here. our standard for the rest of the town should apply here to this facility. So that would be, you know, my don't regulate it because we can't enforce it and it's none of our business. But we do have an expectation as a community that this is what the applicant represented and we should expect them to deal to deliver on what they represented to us.
Okay, Stacey.
I agree with you all that these are not the normal conditions that we put on applications, but as far as other applications that could be like inns and restaurants, we have in the past put regulations on when events can occur in outside venues, times of events, when they begin, when they end, and also noise for any events at any inns or outside venues or even inside venues. So when we look at these, there are some that, and we also have to remember that, yes, it is a land use, but it's also the safety of not only the applicant and the people in these homes, but also the neighborhood. So if we look through these, there are some that we could actually change a bit if it's agreeable or up for discussion, such as noise, such as doors, security, and there was one other one that I saw that could possibly be, one of the ones is closing the front door at 8 o'clock, making sure that the door stays locked and is not propped open, and the noise ordinance. So those are ones that we actually could put in place as conditions on this. Just throwing it out there for discussion.
Okay.
Madam Chair, at the risk of sounding argumentative, if we can't enforce these, if there are internal rules, and if the town has its own standards for things such as noise and safety on the street, why are we insisting that we incorporate these rules by reference or hold them to a standard that we would not hold anyone else in the town to? If I were coming here before this board to do a bed and breakfast application, would you be telling me when I can lock my door, whether I should or shouldn't leave it propped open, whether I can or can't have a safe inside? If I were coming for a special permit to run some kind of event, and I was part of a B&B or something, I would expect to be told when the noise can stop, when I can start, when I can stop my operations, because that's within your purview. But these are internal rules for how they run their own show. This is their business plan. Are we really going to get into the business of telling them how to run their business? Would we do that to any other applicant coming in for a multifamily bed and breakfast or inn kind of an application?
I agree. I think I'm not advocating. I'm just throwing it out there. If a abutter or another tenant in the building said, this is an issue for me that I want to make sure that the doors are always locked, I think that the entrance door to a shared building is always locked. If that is a concern and it's brought forward to this board, we need to consider that. If it's a concern of the abutters of noise for a venue such as this, yes, if that's a concern of the abutters and it's brought forward to this board, we need to consider that for them. So that's where my discussion points come.
How about if we just had the applicant submit something yearly with how they operate? I mean, like they've submitted to us in this application, and if they just submit that yearly, then the public would have the confidence that we have that document, and we would have the confidence that we have it.
I mean, they're
the ones that brought all this up.
Yeah, well, I understand they brought it up, Madam Chairman, but so every year they submit a document saying we're being good people?
No.
And we say No,
they submit their rules or...
They submit their rules of their rules of procedure as they exist at that time, and we take them in and put them into the file.
Right.
What has been accomplished? See, what I'm concerned, what I sense is that because of the facility that it is, they are somehow being considered different from every other facility that might come in.
Right.
And I don't think that's proper. And I don't think that's within this board's purview.
Right. I actually think we should scrap all of it except for the ones that I brought up, because those are the only ones that I thought we could actually put in as a condition, to be honest. So, and if the applicant has any you know, hey, we would do that. I mean, that would be great. Or if there's any abutters out there that I just spoke for that want to get up and speak, please speak.
Okay, why don't you be specific then so that we're all on the same page? Which ones would you
include? The ones that I heard from the ZBA, the first application mm-hmm. a few weeks ago was actually safety from the tenant that lives in the building on the first floor. I don't know if that's still a concern of his or if this would be a concern of his, but when I read that one, that is one that I thought that he may want to see. And the other one would be a noise curfew. I don't think there's anything wrong with saying make sure there, you know, the noise, there is a noise ordinance at 9 p.m. I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. I don't know what the neighbors feel. And basically, that's it.
Okay, well, they would be required to follow the noise ordinance.
That's true, but just like we do for other inns that have outside venues, it's like a double assurance covering.
Mm-hmm. There's no outside venue here. This is all internal on the third floor of a four-story building. Nothing is going on the outside. Why don't we simply hold them responsible to the town's noise ordinance, like every other citizen in town is, and leave it at that?
That's fine. Fine with me. I'm just trying to advocate for the neighbors and the neighborhood.
Mr. Hausman, did you want to weigh in on this?
I think the comments made by Vaughn are all of you are valid. But the issue is that how, one, is this enforceable? I think everybody agrees that the town of Wolfboro is not the entity that would be taking any enforcement action as it relates to this condition if it were to stand. So I take the point made about why have something if it's not enforceable.
Right.
The second is that there is some, the process will be dynamic. This facility is not the other facilities. It will mature, it will grow, it will have different changes. So it's hard to capture that. I think perhaps rather than refer to it as a condition, the board may consider a paragraph before the condition saying, it is our understanding that this is a well-organized, well-run facility with controls in place that address the following.
And they have operational and residency standards.
Yeah.
And that's a great idea.
Yeah.
And then, understanding that, we approve this subject to the following conditions and scrap one.
How does everybody feel about that?
Yeah. That's great.
I think it's good.
Okay. Yep. Everyone done at this end?
I think we could add, you know, they may be adjusted from time to time to suit the needs of the organization.
Yeah.
While they preserve the health, safety, welfare, you know, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Sorry about that.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Rob. I now need to close the public hearing. That means I'm closing the public hearing. Okay. So, Planning Board, we want to change the number one. Who was going to be the brilliant one to come up with the wording? Okay. The operational and residency standards are in place for this facility. Right?
Mm-hmm. And as
presented by the applicant.
And it's not a condition, it is a paragraph.
Right.
Right for the condition.
Yes.
Right.
As presented by the applicant. Okay, and that would address any health and safety issues by just simply saying that, it seems.
Can I clarify are you replacing condition one with a new condition one? Or are you introducing a paragraph prior to conditions that say that the applicant will operate this facility with operational and residency standards in a fashion similar than as submitted in the application?
Right, yeah, what I wrote down was we just sort of amended number one, the operational and residency standards as presented by the applicant.
No, I thought we were going to delete one.
Yeah,
and
we're deleting one.
And do an additional paragraph.
Oh, okay.
So not as a condition. Right. We're just adding the paragraph and deleting it as a condition.
Okay. Yes.
Okay, then the wording.
The wording was as Rob stated.
Okay. That's the record, Rob.
Okay, so it'll be a separate paragraph then.
Something that just says the applicant has represented the following.
Right.
Not that we're holding them to it, but these are the representations made during the process.
That's right. Okay, all right, that's good. Everybody comfortable with that?
As added by the applicant. I mean, didn't we just add those words in there? I mean, that's important because the applicant has put it forward, not us.
Yes, that's what we put at the beginning.
Well, I think the way it's been rephrased by Paul suggests that it's dynamic. But by John, it's more static in time. I think you want to make sure that it's dynamic.
Well, I just want to make sure, John caused me to raise a question. All of these representations are by the applicant,
yes.
Is that correct? Okay. So the applicant has made these representations as a part of their application. We can't, period. Okay?
Yes.
That's as far as I'd go.
Yep.
But it's on the record that those are the representations the applicant made.
Okay. All right. Somebody like to?
I have another.
Let me just mention that the lighting issue has been addressed and the signage issue has been addressed. We're comfortable with the truck deliveries. Any other?
I wonder about the condition that the families would only be those families from the Governor Wentworth Regional School District.
I don't know why we would add that.
You know, there was an implication. Was that, you know, the federal government might be able to come in here and demand that they place families from elsewhere, whereas if it's a condition, they can't.
I'm not sure I would ever take the position that the town of Wolfboro is going to tell the federal government no on anything.
I know.
Having said that, I will make the observation that our welfare department handles anyone who's laid their head down in Wolfboro for a night as a resident of Wolfboro. We're currently doing that. So if they're here, they're ours, and we're going to take care of them.
And I don't know how we fix this, but the representation by the applicant was that this would be inside the Governor Wentworth School District. There is a question raised by one of the citizens that asks, if federal funds are here, does that effect void that representation? That's the question. How we enforce that, how this fits, I think this is just a question the community needs to get answered.
So my understanding of the presentation in total was that they intended to use our welfare director, Amy Muccio, and the homeless coordinator for the school district as the sole references for this facility.
Therefore, the issue is addressed.
And that's their representation.
Yes, right.
Okay.
Okay. Everyone comfortable? If so, would someone be willing to make a motion to approve the Families in Transition Green Mountain Realty LLC application at 16-18 Laner Street? For a change of use to a temporary family transitional housing. This is tax map 217-70 and case 201607. So moved. And that's with
second.
Conditions, right?
With conditions.
With conditions,
okay.
As noted.
Motion has been made and seconded that this application with conditions be approved. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, thank you very much, everyone, for your patience. I know this is a long, painful sometimes project. And now you folks get to go out in the rain and we can stay because we have other applicants.
So lucky.
See you later.
Maybe we need, are you making the call? Stephen Pierce, 46 Point Breeze Road, Tax map 236-2-28, case 201610. This is a site plan review. So we're ready to roll here.
Like a mint.
Wow. Okay.
I've been informed that we're not being heard in the back of the room.
Really?
If we could work on speaking directly into the mic.
Okay.
There you go.
All right.
To orient the board and the audience, the property in question is located in Point Breeze. Point Breeze is off of Pleasant Valley Road. The unit in question is shown here. The proposal is to add a screened-in porch. Your packet includes an architectural rendering of that porch. This will be the third amendment to these condos for this type of structural change. I believe you recall Dr. Sandy Wing and Peter and Patty Cook doing exactly the same thing. The purpose for this is that a condominium is considered a subdivision of land. They own the interior space. The land around it is either held in limited common space, convertible space, or common. And in order to have title to this screened-in porch, they need to make this modification. With that in mind, Madam Chair, I'm going to walk through the planner's review. Fairly quickly. I don't know if the applicant is here tonight. Oh, okay. The applicant is here tonight. This is sort of one of those strange statutory requirements that the planning board must approve for recording at the Registry of Deeds. It's classified as a subdivision by state law, and that's why it's here. With that in mind, we have the proposal to submit to add stairs to an existing, no, excuse me. The proposal is to add a screened-in porch and stairs to unit 28F right here. There's no change in access, no change in parking, no change in landscaping or storm drainage, protection of natural resources. This property is outside all of our setback requirements for wetlands, shorefront, and everything else. Utility, snow storage not applicable. Utilities, no change. Lighting, none proposed. Zoning compliance, this does not create any new nonconformities and is fully compliant with all applicable sections of the Wolfboro Planning and Zoning Ordinance. Litter storage, no outdoor storage is shown or required. It's already on site. Floodplain, the applicant has documented that the portion of the shorefront lot falls within the flood hazard boundary, but this unit falls way outside that. Signage or security for improvement, not applicable. Signage, none proposed, none required. Design review, not applicable generally, but we can talk to the architectural style. It's consistent with the other designs that you've seen. Others, as I pointed out a moment ago, this is a statutory required planning board action. With that, Madam Chair, I believe the application is complete and ready for acceptance, and I'd ask that the applicant or the applicant's agent be allowed to speak to this application.
Okay, and no waivers.
No waivers are requested or required.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much for your patience.
That's okay. My name is Stephen Pierce, and I think Mr. Hausman covered all the points, and I'm just here in case you have any questions.
Okay. Anyone have any questions, comments? Anyone down at this end?
And this has been approved by the Condominium Association?
It's been approved by the ARC Committee, and then after it gets approved here, it gets voted on by the association.
Okay, all right. Anything else, folks? Okay, I guess we're all set. Okay, the application is complete, and would somebody be willing to make a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Thank you. Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, I'm going to open the public hearing on this issue for the Point Breeze Condominium. Any member of the public want to comment on this? Okay. Mr. Hausman, do you have some conditions we should consider?
Staff is recommending the following conditions of approval. One, the plan one, proposed condominium expansion plan, unit 28F, Point Breeze Condominium, 46 Point Breeze Road, prepared by Norway Plains Survey Associates, dated July 10th, 2015. Plan two, noted as A1 screen porch, prepared by Richard Holt, New Hampshire licensed architect, Cormick Construction Management, dated December 18, 2015. Plan three, A2, screen porch addition, framing plan, section and detail, also designed by Richard Holt, dated December 18, 2015. And finally, plan four, A3, screen porch addition, Section C, IRC code, guard cable rail, cable guard rail. Boy, is it hard to use this mic and read.
You're doing fine.
Prepared by Richard Holt, New Hampshire licensed architect, again dated December 18, 2015. Condition two, the applicant shall submit a Mylar for recording at the Carroll County Registry of Deeds. And condition three, the applicant shall be responsible for the payment of all recording fees.
Okay, thank you. Any questions about the conditions? All right, let me close the public hearing. Somebody wants to make a motion to approve this porch addition.
I make a motion that we approve case number 201610, tax map 236-2-28, with conditions stated.
Okay. Seconded.
Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, thank you. Did you send a thing to me? No, this one will take a couple of minutes. The next application, Dorothy Hubbard Revocable Trust, 116 Middleton Road, tax map 268-22, case 201611. This is a two-lot subdivision.
To orient the board and the audience, the property in question is on Middleton Road. This is Rusty Lane for point of reference right here. And heading out in this direction is the electric department. The property in question is highlighted in yellow on this map. The total piece is shown here in yellow. There is a boundary line being proposed here that would carve off the main house. And with that, I'm going to turn the plan over.
Road.
proposal is to as submitted is to seek a two-lot subdivision of tax map 268-22, and the results will be lot one, including the main house right here, and a guest cottage existing on the lot right here. Consisting of it shall consist of 5 acres and 444.48 feet of frontage on Middleton Road. This lot will have no shore frontage. Lot two shall consist of 19.61 acres and 268.38 feet of frontage on Middleton Road, right here, and 463 feet of frontage on Russ Pond, right here. The applicant attached is the applicant's letter explaining the rationale behind this request. Please note that so for access, lot one is fully developed. It has a driveway access off of it. At such time that lot two is developed, lot two will require a driveway permit from Wolfboro Public Works Department, previously New Hampshire DOT. And at that time, we'll address the stormwater issues associated with that drive cut. Parking and circulation, again, lot one is developed and is in full compliance. Lot two, this section is not applicable. Storm drainage, it's a subdivision of raw land, not the development of land, so it's not applicable. Snow storage, not applicable. Utilities, the proposed subdivision has received approval from both the electric department and public works department. It should be noted that town water is in Middleton Road at this location. Lighting, none proposed, none required. This is the subdivision of raw land. Protection of natural resources. The plan denotes a corner of this lot having jurisdictional wetlands. They've designed, the lot is laid out in such a way that no impact to those wetlands are required to access the building lot area, and the setbacks are shown on the plan. In addition, zoning compliance, this property falls in two zoning districts. The first zoning district being the shorefront residential, which is this strip of land 250 feet back from Russ Pond. The balance of the district being the general residential district, the residential district. Shorefront residentials, 1 acre minimum lot size, 150 feet of frontage on a road, 150 feet of frontage on the pond. This lot exceeds all of those requirements. With regards to the residential district, the minimum lot size again is 1 acre and 150 feet of frontage. Both lots meet or exceed the requirements of the underlying zoning district. Floodplain, the applicant has documented that the lot do not fall within the flood. The applicant has documented that the lots do not fall within the limits of the flood hazard boundaries as shown on panel 745 of the flood rate maps of the town of Wolfboro, dated March 19, 2013. Security for improvements, not applicable. This is the subdivision of raw land. The only thing that they need to do is to pin the corners of the new property bound, and no improvements are needed for that. Signage, none proposed. Design review, not applicable. Other, the applicant is seeking a waiver of the HIS mapping or soils mapping requirements of the town of Wolfboro. The rationale has been presented. This waiver is in part based on the fact that both lots exceed the 5 acre minimum requirement that exempts them from the New Hampshire subdivision requirement. So both lots exceed the need to file for New Hampshire subdivision. And secondly, the test pit data shows adequate receiving area for a 4,000 K area on the lot. With that in mind, Madam Chair, I'd ask that the applicant speak to the application, address any questions you have with regards to the waiver, and subject to the granting of this waiver, the application is complete and ready for acceptance.
Okay, thank you. You'll have to get used to our new digs.
Yeah, right? I guess so. Randy Tatro, Norway Plains, for the applicant. this evening. Essentially, two-lot subdivision, as Rob said, 26 acres, cutting out five with the existing house, a former residence of Dorothy Hubbard. We have shown a potential building area. Hope I don't have to drive. Thank you. Okay. We've shown a potential building area in this area of the property in a test bit perk test. There's an existing entrance there that was done for logging purposes. That would, as Rob stated, would have to be get approval from the town if a residential situation was proposed there. I wanted to show a proposed building area that was suitable on the existing, on the remaining property, even though it's 19.6 acres. We did have topography of the property, and there was a small portion of wetlands down in this area that we did delineate and show on the plan. And as Rob stated, the five acre lot around the existing dwelling was free of wetlands and had its already had existing septic systems and is tied into town water. The rationale for the waiver is similar that we've discussed before. The waivers that I requested were the same sections that require Order 1 or HIS mapping soils. Those are normally done for situations where we have to prove lot size by soil type. And in the regulations, the most stringent requirement I think you got in lot size by soil type, in other than an east slope, is 86,000 square feet, and obviously, you know, 86,000 square feet is about 2 acres. So these both far exceed that, notwithstanding the 15% reduction for being tied into town water. So in this particular case, the information for a high intensity soil survey wouldn't have served a purpose. If they were smaller, if they were around 3 acres or 4 acres, then that would have potentially been the situation. So that was the reason for those sections of the requirements and the subdivision regulations that we're asking for waiver for.
Okay, and you did check the standardized lot shape, and it does comply.
Yeah, and in my narrative, even though we are exempt from that for the reasons I stated, one I think because of frontage, and the other one because of lot size, They both met it. The back one eked by 30.2, and I think the requirement's 35. So I put them on there because I wanted to give you guys an idea what the form factor would be in that particular shape.
Okay.
So I think the front one came out 25, which was what you originally wanted. And the back one came out 30. So even with that kind of lot shape, with that large of a perimeter, you can see that it would still meet it. If we had a rat tail, you know, if we had a odd shaped piece coming off of that, then that might have thrown it off.
Right, okay. Okay, you mentioned a lot line revision in 2002. What was?
In 2002. Okay, the lot line revision in 2002.
A lot line relocation.
Yeah, it was down in this area from Mr. Hackett. Well, there was an original lot down there that a lot line adjustment was performed back in the late 90s. And I think Mr. Berlin did a shoreline permit, and they've got approval for a dwelling in this area. When the deed was conveyed from Dorothy and Leonard to Mr. Hackett, they reserved a small 19. It's weird that it's exact 19 point whatever it was, but it was a reserved non-cut area adjacent to that lot. That's what I mentioned in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Any questions? Yep. Okay. Let's see. It seems as if Mr. Hausman and Mr. Tatro have given us enough information to justify granting the requested waiver. So would somebody like to make a motion to grant that waiver?
So moved.
Second. Thank you. Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, and with the granting of the waiver, the application is now complete.
I make a motion that we accept case number 201611 as complete.
Seconded.
Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, since the application is complete, I can now open the public hearing for this project. So if anybody has any comments, now would be the time to state them. This is the Hubbard subdivision that we're talking about. You may need to pull that mic down.
I'm Ruth Webb, and we own property 27, yes, and also 23 that goes in the back part that abuts up to So this subdivision just makes provisions for one division off of it. It doesn't have anything to do with all the rest of this. Is that correct?
There's just one other lot other than the developed lot being proposed.
Right. Just one more lot to make the Hubbard's property bigger so that they can have a proper... Are they going to be building in that?
I'm not sure.
They're just subdividing off the house on 5 acres and leaving the remaining parcel. The only reason we showed a building spot is just to prove to the planning board that there wasn't. But there's no plans according to the applicant, I think.
And that just goes off of here.
Yeah,
it doesn't have anything to do.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Hi.
Hi, Madam Chairman, woman, I'm sorry. My name is David Hart. I would just like to draw to the attention of the committee that Dorothy Hubbard, the estate of Dorothy Hubbard is still in litigation, and that the legal issues still have not been resolved. And I would like to also bring to the attention that the committee that the smaller lot size proposed there is outside the parameters of the trust. And I suggest that this matter be tabled until it can be further resolved. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Tatro, do you want to comment on that?
I don't have any legal authority to say one way or another. I'm acting on behalf of the executor of the estate who signed the application and is proposing to the board under the subdivision regulations whether it's approvable or not. As far as any outside litigation, I'm sure that would be part of it in one form or another. But I really can't speak to the legalities of that other than what I was requested to do.
Okay. Mr. Hausman, did you have any comments?
Guidance.
Note for the record that the application is signed by the administrator and executor of the estate of the trust, and the appointment of agent is noted in your application packet also. I would advise the board that this would be a civil matter, not within your purview, and that that it would be resolved by a court action outside any action by this board. You have an application pending signed by a duly authorized agent of the trust. I would suspect that you were obligated to act on the request unless it was not in order.
Okay, so everything that we're required to have submitted has been submitted in proper order.
Correct.
Yeah, okay, all right, thank you. One other issue, we did receive an email from Robert Levy, 551 South Main Street. And Mr. Tedro, you commented on this. Do you want to speak to the issue? I think all of the board members received.
So did you receive my comment?
We did.
Okay. Yeah, we've had conversations with Mr. Levy. As you know, I'm a member of the Conservation Commission, so we had previous discussions with Mr. Levy.
Can you just show people in case they don't know where the property is referring to?
Mr. Levy owns the property, and it would be on the east side of this lot. He also owns it all the way over to Boulder Road and the backside of Russ Pond, near the conservation area and the Avery property. The question that Mr. Levy has is whether or not this old Woods Road, a tote road that's shown on previous surveys and stuff, whether or not he has a deeded right to pass and repass over it. So, as I stated in my email, and as I've discussed with Mr. Levy in the past, I have reviewed all the documentation to the extent that my license requires, and I do not see documented proof of a deeded easement across there. And as my note also states, notwithstanding any proven prescriptive easement by usage or anything like that that can be proven, again, civilly or by a court of law or whatever, some of the information that Mr. Levy provided, for lack of a better term, I can't make that jump title-wise, not to say that there isn't something that could be brought up. But in this particular case, it mentions a right-of-way in Mr. Levy's deed only. The previous deeds don't mention it. So you have to have basis for a right-of-way. Secondly, what it says is there's a right-of-way mentioned in Hubbard's deed. There is. But all it says in Hubbard's deed is that it's subject to any right-of-ways or easements that may exist. And that's basically a catch-all phrase that routinely is put in there. So in order for me to say unequivocally that someone has the right in a specific spot, a specific distance, then I need something a little better than that to hang my hat on. So I think the note covers it correctly and sufficiently. And as Forrest Gump said, that's all I got to say about that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, any more issues? Okay, Mr. Hausman, did you have some conditions for us to consider?
I guess I'm still unclear as to what guidance, what's your guidance, Rob, on the prospective litigation? Proceed.
I find myself a little bit troubled by that, too.
Well,
and only because
I have no idea what the litigation is.
Well, neither do I, and the gentleman who came up and mentioned that there was some problem didn't present anything to support that other than his statement.
Right.
So it's not really safe to accept that as the same level of testimony as Randy's application, but on the other hand, it leaves me a little bit uncertain.
I have the ability to call our counsel. If you would like to give me 5 minutes, I can step out, make a phone call, and come back with the answer.
Well, we have no detail as to what the litigation is. We don't know whether it's a litigation over the
property,
the boundaries, ownership, but yet we are here to take a look at what we know to be on the record, the property.
Correct.
So perhaps we say this is all. We proceed with our deliberations subject to the outcome of any litigation would trump what we do anyway.
Correct.
Oh, then we're fine.
Yes.
Then I have no
problem. Or you could get more information for us for our next meeting. We could continue.
I could have counsel. I spoke with counsel at about 5 o'clock tonight, and she said she'd be available by phone if necessary.
I don't think it's necessary. I think if it is indeed the case that any decision that we make will be trumped by litigation, If that claim is shown to be correct, then we might just as well proceed.
Yep.
Okay, so everybody wants to move on? Okay, all right.
Staff is recommending the following conditions of approval. One, that the plans as submitted and amended to tonight be adopted by reference, and that's plan one. Subdivision plan prepared by Norway Plains, dated May 2016, and plan two, topographic subdivision plan, also prepared by Norway Plains, dated May 2016. Condition two, the applicant shall submit a Mylar plan for recording at the Carroll County Registry of Deeds. Condition three, the applicant shall be responsible for the payment of all recording fees. Condition four, the applicant shall be responsible for the monumentation and submittal of the certified monumentation and updated plans. And condition five, I actually don't believe is applicable because no new information has been submitted, so you can scratch condition five.
We can strike that.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to close the public hearing. Board members, do you have any issues with this? If not, if somebody would like to make a motion to approve the Dorothy Hubbard Revocable Trust two-lot subdivision at 116 Middleton Road, tax map 268-22, case 201611, with conditions.
So moved.
Thank you.
I'll second John's
motion.
Motion's
been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. All right. Thank you very much, folks. All right.
It's a gift.
It's a gift.
Ravens Trust, 291 Center Street. Tax map 177-30, case 201612. And this is for a three-lot subdivision. Oh dear. Somebody's going to be looking for those pretty soon, right? Where were they on the chair? Oh, gosh.
What are they?
Glasses.
I don't think anyone's going to be looking for his glasses. He's going to be going, oh, I can't see.
Feeling
dry. Those people that are looking for the glasses. There you go. Hey, if they fit, what the heck?
I need them.
Pretty close, aren't they, huh?
It's like a nice pair of Maui gyms. Okay.
All right. Do you need the plan review? There you go. Okay.
To orient the board and the audience, the property in question is on Center Street. Most of us would probably know it as the old Raven Cottages site. It has a big red barn here right along the road. There used to be a bunch of rental cottages back here. It has frontage on the basin. Walk everybody through the planner review. And I hope everyone got the email page two in front of you. The proposal is to create lot one, 1.859 acres, 202 feet of frontage on Center Street, 257 feet of frontage on the shore of Fernald's Basin. It should be noted that there's a proposed driveway. There's currently a driveway that crosses over the corner of that property line, and there's a proposed driveway that'll move completely onto lot one. Lot 2 will include the existing five-bedroom dwelling and shall consist of 1.951 acres, 194.35 feet of frontage on Center Street here, and 312 feet of frontage on the basin. Lot 3 shall consist of 2.48 acres, 482 feet of frontage on Center Street, and 506 feet of frontage on Fernald's Basin. The property has been HIS mapped, high intensity soil survey mapped. It has topography and test pit data on the two unbuilt lots. The proposed access requires a New Hampshire DOT drive permit. At the TRC, the applicant's agent represented the New Hampshire DOT is okay with the proposed modifications. I failed to mention that there is an existing drive over here that will be moved slightly east so that it's completely contained on lot 3.
Which one of those driveways was in the TRC? That one?
All three were discussed at TRC. Lot 1 and Lot 3 need New Hampshire DOT approval, and they represented that the New Hampshire DOT were okay with the proposal, and I'll ask the applicant's agent to speak to that specifically. Parking and circulation, Lot 2 is the only one developed, and it's fully compliant with that provision of our ordinance. Landscaping, not applicable. Storm drainage, not applicable. Snow storage, not applicable. Utilities, the proposed subdivision has received approval from the electric department. It should say electric department only. Actually, this does have town water in front of it, correct. And town public works. Town water runs to basically the Quonset hut, Allen A. So there is municipal water in this location. Lighting, not applicable, none proposed. Zoning compliance, this property falls within two zoning districts, the shorefront residential and a very small corner of the lot. One, for the most part, falls within the residential district. Minimum lot size for both, 1 acre and 150 feet of frontage on the street. The shorefront lots require 150 feet of frontage on the basin. All exceed the minimum requirements for frontage, area, and shore frontage. Litter storage, not applicable. Floodplain, staff has documented a small portion of the property falls within the flood hazard boundary. This is a dam-controlled lake, so only a very narrow strip along the shorefront falls within the flood hazard boundary. Security for improvements, none proposed, none required. Signage, none proposed, none required, not applicable. Design review, not applicable. Other issues outstanding, New Hampshire DOT driveway permit, New Hampshire DES subdivision permit, review for acceptance. There are no waivers requested. This application is complete and ready for acceptance. Again, I would ask the applicant's agent to be able to speak to this application and specifically speak to the New Hampshire DOT driveway permit and the New Hampshire DES subdivision permit.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brian Berlind. I'm a licensed land surveyor and president of Land Tech with an office in Osby on Route 28. With me tonight is David Childers, one of the trustees of the Ravens Trust. And as Rob explained, they own a just over 6 acre parcel of land with ample road and water frontage. They wish to subdivide into three lots. Lot one is the most westerly lot right there, will contain 1.86 acres and have 203 feet of frontage on the road and about 250 on the water. As Rob did explain, there's a driveway, but first off, the parent tract has three driveways, one here just inside of the new lot two Inside the building and between the barn is a second driveway, and the third driveway is right there, again, just inside lot two. This proposal, as we subdivide the three lots, is to relocate those driveways just slightly inside the lot lines for site distance. We don't yet have DOT approval. I have talked with Steve Druin of DOT, and he's going to look at the site in detail this week, so he promised. If there's an Achilles heel, it would be the lot three driveway on this, where it was so close when I did my modeling, he's going to do his own. As Rob explained, lot two has almost 194 feet of frontage and 1.95 acres of land. And lot three takes the remainder of 540 feet of road frontage and 2.5 acres of land. All the lots meet DES standards. That permit is also pending. And all the lots meet the municipal lot loading or soil lot sizing by soil type standards. So subject to the DOT and DES approvals, this subdivision is pretty straightforward.
But DES has everything.
They do, yes.
Okay.
So, I've got a question. So would that be the rise that they...
Yes, the peak of this hill is right in front of that existing home. And if you go too far away from the peak of the hill, you can't see over it to get that needed site distance.
Okay. Would there be a remedy?
If DOT fails one, it'll be lot three, because that is the most marginal one, and we would just erase the 2-3 lot line, and this would quickly become a two-lot subdivision.
But there's an existing driveway that runs down the lot line that you propose?
Say again, please.
There is an existing driveway now running down the lot line you propose.
That existing driveway is just adjacent to the barn, right there, just to the west of the new lot three line. We're going to move that driveway easterly, about the width of the driveway, to service lot three.
If you raise the elevation, would you be able to see over the rise in your driveway?
It's a good thought, but when you're putting a driveway in, at least on a state road, it's supposed to downgrade a little bit first instead of draining onto the road. There may be some give and take between the applicant and DOT just for those kinds of things, if need be.
You mean the give and take would be the elimination of a lot?
No, maybe raising the driveway or shimmying the driveway a little bit.
Okay, well, you did mention elimination.
No, that'd be all take if we had to do that.
Okay.
Or give, I should say.
All right.
Any more questions?
No, I think you were very complete. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
No waivers needed, so this application is complete. Somebody would be willing to make a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Thank you.
Seconded.
Motion has been made and seconded to accept this application as complete. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Okay, I'm going to open the public hearing. Anyone that wants to speak to this application now is, or ask any questions, or give us your thoughts. Come on up, please.
Yes, I just have a slightly uneducated question about it.
Okay.
How is this
Could you tell us who you are, please?
I'm Vanessa Urquhart. I live directly across the street from what's going to be proposed as lot three, where this new driveway will be going in.
Okay.
My concern is the tree line that's there. If that tree line is removed, how that'll affect taxes in regard to views at that point at my end. So.
Okay.
Is this the tree line running along the highway that you're discussing?
Where this third driveway is going.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
You're on the other side of the road. Yes. Any trees going down would improve the site distance for not only the subject lot, but I can't imagine improving yours, but I don't see it making it any worse. I'm not an expert to reply to that, as I'm not a tax assessor. That would take one sharp-eyed tax assessor to catch that. Not that he's not sharp-eyed, but I just don't.
But I don't think there's anything to do about it. If your neighbor cuts down all of his trees and gives you a view, then you could be taxed because you now have a view.
That existing driveway is right here, just inside.
No. Go up.
Okay, well, Mr. Hausman is going to.
That's not uneducated, that's fascinating.
That's a good one. Scary, too.
While it is a concern for the abutter, it's not within your purview to address. You can recognize it as a potential issue, but the owner could clear cut the lot today. And the same issue would exist. Trees are owned by the property owner. Their right to remove them is there, and the assessed value is different, is determined by our assessor, not by the land use board.
Okay. And it looks like the width of the driveway would be, you know, the amount of cut.
Yes.
It's not very wide, and it's not directly across the street from you.
As a property owner, the property owner has the right to retain any tree or remove any tree. And I'm not sure that the conversation should be, we can address the issue of taxation based on whether the driveway moves or whether the property owner chooses to clear cut the property. It's outside your purview.
Thank you. Other comments from folks?
Hi, Maggie Steer. I live sort of across from proposed lot three, the furthest east end, and I just wanted to point out that there's a lot of wetlands there, and so that would be completely off limits. Is that right for any building? That's one question. I have several questions. Do you want me to just ask them all?
Okay.
Okay.
The wetlands.
The wetlands.
So
I just
we'll have the applicant address all of your
okay.
issues.
Yeah, I'm okay. also concerned that there's a fairly steep slope on these lots leading down to the shore of the lake, and that construction runoff may carry a lot of phosphorus into the water. So I don't know if that's within your purview, but I'd love to hear what you have to say about that.
Okay.
My third comment has to do with traffic, and I know that this is a DOT decision, but already the traffic moves fairly quickly along Center Street, particularly during high volume times, and I am very concerned about safety issues with adding additional driveways and additional cars coming in and out, because there'll be three houses where now there's one. So those are my biggest concerns, and I really share Vanessa's concern, too. I think that's a very interesting point, that if suddenly you have a view of the lake where you didn't before, on the one hand, isn't that great? And on the other hand, if your taxes double, that's not so great. So those are my concerns for now, and I'd love to have you address them. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Would you like to address those issues? Wetlands, steep slope, and traffic slash.
Could you also just show a building area for each lot? For
right.
Sure, I'll do my best. Lot three clearly is the lot that has the most wetlands. It's shown right there, and there is a seasonal runoff that flows through the property. Please note that lot three is also the largest lot, about 2.5 acres, so there's while there may be unbuildable zones in there due to wetlands, there's still ample buildable areas due to wetlands.
I think, if I may, she was particularly concerned about runoff into the lake, particularly phosphorus from treated lawns and plants and shrubs and things.
Well, these lots are not only in the municipal shorefront zone, they're also in the state shore land zone, and there are statutes and regulations in place to prevent that. Any new construction would have to get a shoreland permit showing the land being properly stabilized after construction, and a municipal shoreland permit showing the same thing, that soils and construction would be done in a way to minimize those effects.
And then the third was traffic.
Yes.
I'm sorry, traffic.
Traffic and safety.
There are three driveways there now, and that's part of the basis of the DOT allowing three to remain. If they weren't there, this might be a different discussion.
Okay. Does that address your issues?
It does, but I have a fourth.
Can you...
I know there's something else, and you're all going to laugh, but I really do have to say this, that that's beautiful historic property and, you know, sort of a key feature of that part of Route 28. And at the current time, there is nothing to prevent the loss of these historic properties. As the new chair of the Heritage Commission, I would just like to express my dismay over that. And I'm sorry to hear that. The prediction is those buildings will go because they represent what was once a key area of farming for the town of Wolfboro.
What would you propose?
What would I propose?
Yes.
Actually, I've thought about it quite a bit, and my hope would be that perhaps the buildings could be moved back a little to be relocated on the lot so that they weren't so close to the road, but that they could still be usable. And I'd love for that to be considered as an option.
At whose expense?
At the owner's expense, rather than building a whole new house and paying for demolition. And obviously, I mean, I can't mandate what they do. That's not what I'm suggesting at all. I'm just saying it's too bad that we might be losing nice historic houses, and I hope that consideration will be given, and if the money works out in a favorable way, that the owner will choose to retain the historic buildings rather than build new. That's all. It's just kind of sad if we lose them. That's all. I just had to say it. You know me. You know I have to say
Thank
these
you.
Things.
Okay.
Okay.
Nope.
Legitimate. No. Go ahead. Again, look what's happening to the Pickering House, so never say never. Mr. Hausman, I don't know if Brian was serious or not about eliminating one of the lots, but you don't just, once we approve a plan, you don't just erase a lot line to come back to us, right? Just so. Hi.
My name is David Childers. I'm the one who owns the property over there. My neighbors. How are you doing? At one time, we had six cottages on the property when we bought it 31 years ago, and we ran it as summer resort for 30 years, 29, I believe. And it just is not a growing business in a town of Wolfboro. And we took three cottages down about 15 years ago. The last three were taken down a year and a half ago with the permits from the town to do that. So we've had it for a long time. I really do not want to divide it or do anything like that, but the taxes keep going up. I've retired, my wife has retired. We have made the decision that we want to break it into smaller lots. Now, Steve Druin with the DOT, I have met with him a couple times over the last year and a half, and he's good. He's not officially good, but he's good with the driveway over on the other side of the barn. Okay. His worry was more for the driveway on this side, on that little bit of a lip, and having the 400 feet to see. And he has come out, and he and I have walked it, measured it, he's driven it, and he's talked to his boss about it. So they have a file already on the driveways.
Okay.
So I cannot speak for him, but he liked the barn one more than he liked the other one.
Well, and the other comment is that you already have three driveways, and they do roughly go to the three different lots. Right. I mean, even if you didn't get permission to move them, you could still
have
the three lots.
Driveways.
Yeah.
That's yes.
True. You just right. have to do easements of some sort.
And in reality, there might be less traffic coming out of the driveways than there were during the summer when we had people renting the cottages.
Good right. point.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, anything else? All right. Planning board members, you're all set. Rob, do you have some conditions?
Actually, you were asking me a question first.
What?
I believe you were asking me a question first regarding they can't.
Oh, yes, that's right. I did ask you a question. Are you going to answer that?
I do have an answer. I'm going to offer conditions of approval that if they can't comply with, would need to come back to this board for an amendment.
Yes.
Okay.
And yeah, okay. All right. Well, I just thought we'd better say that. Okay, thank you.
Staff is recommending that the plans, the following conditions of approval, plan one, sheet one of two, three-lot subdivision prepared for Raisman Trust by Land Tech Technical Services, dated May 17, 2016, be adopted by reference, and plan two, three-lot subdivision, be adopted also by reference. Condition two, the applicant shall submit a Mylar plan for recording at Carroll County Registry of Deeds. Condition three, the applicant shall be responsible for payment of all recording fees. Condition four, the applicant shall be responsible for monumentation and the submittal of a monument certification and update of plans. I'm going to delete condition five and add a new condition five that New Hampshire DES and New Hampshire DOT permits are adopted by reference. Any modification that would change this plan would need to require a plan amendment.
Okay. All right. Everyone all right with that? Okay. Thank you. I'll close the public hearing. And if everyone is all set, somebody be willing to make a motion to approve with conditions the Ravens Trust three-lot subdivision, 291 Center Street, tax map 177-30, case 201612.
Seconded by
me. Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks,
folks. Okay, we just have a couple more items. Okay, the first one is a lot merger, tax map 231-60 and 61. This is the merger of the lot with the library.
Madam Chairman, I'll recuse myself on this.
Okay.
Madam Chair, the proposal is to create a single 2.9-acre parcel with 243.46 acres of frontage, feet of frontage on South Main Street. The merged lot, as noted, will be the library lot in total. Please note that 231-61, which used to contain a dwelling, is now a vacant lot, will be eliminated, resulting in one less building lot. You'll note that the code enforcement officer's letter is attached, that this does not cause any issues. No, has no findings associated with this proposal.
Okay.
Is that building in shadow gone?
Yes.
This is the property that was purchased a few years ago
yes.
by the town, and the building was raised?
Yes.
To make a view for the...
library modifications or parking.
Well, I thought it was to make view for the fire department.
No.
I thought it was to make view for the fire department had access to the road and they didn't.
Wrong side of the library.
You're thinking
wrong
of side of the library.
You're looking at the other side.
I got it. And that has that not been merged into this lot yet?
So lot 59 is part of is separate lot of record, but is attached to and used by the police and fire department.
Right.
That has not been merged at this time.
Hmm.
Any reason? Just hasn't gotten to it? Okay.
Lot 61 is the lot in question, and it was purchased.
Okay,
the Bun McBride piece is the one you're referring.
We approve it.
Okay. Motion has been made to approve this lot merger. The motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. And then another lot merger of tax map 190-44 and 45.
This property is located on Elm Street. It's a very small lot. The existing lot of record with the dwelling on it is 0.24 acres. The lot 45, as shown on the map, is 0.15 acres. It's a funny L-shaped parcel that runs out behind, and actually the L addition on the main house extends into this lot. The proposal is to merge the two together, eliminating 190.45, lot 45, creating a 0.39 acre parcel and 155 feet of frontage on Elm Street.
Doesn't eliminate a building lot?
It does.
It does?
Yeah.
Really?
Pre-existing
non-conforming lot with 50 feet of frontage, with a setback requirement, you'd probably have a 20-foot wide house.
It's possible.
Possible. I know people who design them.
I know.
Okay. Any issues with this merger?
Nope.
Anybody want to make a motion, please?
Make a motion that we approve lot merger for tax map 190-44 and 45.
Second.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Thank you. And that, the minutes. Of
public comment.
May.
Action.
Well, it's not okay. On the, do you want me to see if they want to say something? Did you folks want to say anything to us, or you just didn't want to get wet, right?
Didn't want to get wet.
Okay, the May 24th minutes, I just had one correction at the top of,
thank you, Rob.
Of page 3. It says, I said the master plan speaks to this issue, and then it says, she recommended against issuing building permits. I didn't recommend that. I said that the master plan recommends against issuing. I wouldn't want anybody to think that I had prejudged anything without considering it very
there
carefully.
There you go.
Any other corrections?
Who's correcting? Who's correcting? Okay.
Okay, so we all set?
Mm-hmm.
You want to make a motion to approve May 24th, 2016 minutes?
So moved.
Second. Corrected.
Seconded.
Motion has been made and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. All right. Anything else we need to worry about tonight, Rob?
Don't get hit by lightning.
Okay. Good job, everybody.
Move to adjourn.
All right. Thank you.
What do you do?
Motion has been made and seconded to adjourn.